show is not intended for people under the age of 13. You have been warned. Hi guys, welcome back to another video, and today I'm going to be doing another top 20 ranked. I know I'm a week late, I'm sorry. Anyway, I just had no motivation to film last week, and that's really all she wrote, so I'm gonna get on with it. So, how are we doing in terms of the charts? Well, I will say that 2020 has been a very interesting, well, somewhat stagnant chart year. Not entirely stagnant, but most of the songs that have stuck around are pretty stagnant, and then a bunch of songs have just come and gone. Nothing's really had any sort of staying power, which is definitely interesting to see. It's going to be really interesting to see what songs actually manage to scrape onto the year-end list. But I feel like at the end of the day, I have to come to the conclusion that 2020 is a very interesting chart year that I don't care about, and I've been paying very little attention to. I know I'm not doing my job properly, except it's not my job because I don't get paid for it, so ay! But no, but for real, I should probably say that I've made it no secret that I'm a K-pop fanatic, and by K-pop, I don't mean the stuff I'm going to talk about on this top 20 ranked. I mean stuff that would never ever touch the top 100 ever, because it's way too Korean. Not that that's a bad thing, I'm just saying. Americans are boring. You get the fucking point. Anyway, I'm just going to point out that I got really burned out of covering the American charts around the time pandemic started, and you know that, because I didn't do it for 5 months, and yeah, I'm a week late again, I know, but I'll be honest, I haven't been listening to much Western music at all, and it's not because I'm trying to be a snob or say that Western music is bad, it's just because I got burned out. That's all I can really say at this point. You know, it's kind of like when someone gets burned out of listening to the Hot 100 and starts listening to alternative rock or indie pop. That's the same thing, except for me it's K-pop, so you get the idea. Anyway, I'm just gonna get it out of the way. This was a slightly lower score, a 62 out of 100, still decent, and there isn't too much else to say, so I'm going to get straight into the list.
Scoop-dee-dee-whoop, whoop-dee-scoop-dee-poop, poop-dee-scoop-dee-scoop-dee-whoop.
Chris fucking Brown. Need I say more?
I'm the bad guy.
Duh.
Out of all the people to bring back in 2020, I can't believe we decided to bring back Jason Derulo. Oh yeah, by the way, the song sucks. I literally have nothing else to say about this that I didn't say last month.
Gonna keep on twiddling them thumbs, skiddly-dee-dum-dum.
So, Louis Capaldi has another hit. He kicked Gabby Barrett out of the top 10, which is just funny, considering the fact that Gabby Barrett was even in the top 10. A female country artist was in the top 10. Well, wasn't Maren Morris doing that a few months ago? Anyway, you get the point. I don't even think she made it to the top 10. She made it to the top 10 in my ranking, though. Top 5. But what do I say about this song? Well, nothing. There's literally nothing to say about a Louis Capaldi song. Singing's overdone, the instrumental was bare bones and annoying. I would admit the song has a bit more punch to it than Someone You Loved, but it also has a freaking guitar line, and I hate that shit. Anyway, otherwise, this is a completely forgettable song that if it came on the radio, I wouldn't turn off, but I definitely wouldn't listen to, and I wouldn't care about. This is the kind of thing I would play if there's nothing else coming on. I really don't have anything else to say about this. Before You Go by Louis Capaldi. The most mediocre song ever. Yikes. And man, I'm glad that Maroon 5 song hasn't gotten popular. I probably just jinxed something. Shit. Well, this is a song that I just don't really have anything to say about in terms of the song itself. I don't really connect with this. It doesn't have a beat that's particularly memorable. It's not really anything I would go and listen to on my own. There really isn't too much to say about it. I'm genuinely not sure who Lil TJ is, and I don't like him on this. And Pop Smoke. The fact it is getting posthumous charting hits, I guess is a good thing, and we'll talk about one of the other ones a bit later on, but for now, I've not been super impressed. I'm not much of a rap listener to begin with, if that helps with anything, but yeah. Anyway, rest in peace, man, and who the hell is this little TJ guy? I swear I've heard him somewhere before. Let me just type this into my Spotify. Lil TJ. I don't see anything. Oh, he was on that Pop Out song last year. Oh, that would explain why I've heard him. He also has a song called Sex Sounds. No comment. Drake. Just Drake. need I say more? Okay, I'm not gonna cut the transition that quickly. What else do I really have to say about this song? Laugh now, cry later? Sure, whatever. The song's fine. I don't mind it. Again, it's not something I would ever turn off if it came on the radio, but it's just something I can't get behind. I just don't care. I don't know who Lil Durk is. I don't care. This is probably objectively way better than the next song I'm going to talk about, but it's a song that I'm way less likely to want to listen to, so I really don't have anything else to say about that. Oh god, this one. As you're probably going to notice, I have Blackpink as my new channel outro, so yeah, I might like this group. And my opinions about Selena Gomez's music have been all over the place, from absolutely loving some of her songs to being alright with them, to thinking her songs are kind of mediocre and forgettable, to thinking they're downright hilarious. Ahem, rare. Ahem. But what else do I really have to say about this? I've seen people call this the female yummy. I think that's a bit harsh. I can't go that far with it. Because at least it's just something mildly enjoyable to listen to, unlike Yummy, which is just skin crawling. Here, the beat isn't the problem. The problem is how awkward everything is, including the lyrics, which were not awkward because they're written by some Korean record exec who's like, hey, let's make a song for Blackpink. No, they're awkward because they're written by Ariana Grande and Victoria Monet. I mean, are we really surprised at this point? Are we really surprised that Victoria Monet and Ariana Grande wrote this? Remember that Ariana Grande is one of the many writers credited on this song. No, seriously. If I made a top 10 list of Ariana Grande's worst lyrics, half of them would be from this song. Anyway, where was my point again? Ariana Grande. Yeah, also, I hope you like this beat, because that's the only thing you're going to be hearing. Now, again, I feel like this passes on, I like the bass, the charisma of the girls. They can sell it, kind of. I feel like Ariana Grande herself could have sold this better. As much as the lyrics are awkward, they're Ariana's lyrics. And the vocals that she has, I think Rosé hitting on the chorus. It's very high. In other words, it sounds like something Ariana wrote for herself. There really isn't much else to say about that. Selena's fine on the song. I'm honestly glad it's not Ariana with Blackpink, because Ariana would overpower them, but the lyrics are just weird. I think it's trying to be sexy, and then there's just all this other weird stuff thrown in there too, like flexing. I do like Lisa's rap bit a good bit. At the end, some of the lyrics are just completely nonsensical. I'm pretty sure ice cream belongs in the freezer. Belongs in the freezer and not fridge. And some of the metaphors here are just, ugh. I'm sorry, I've never been into this type of thing to begin with. But something about the video just made me awkward. There's a lot of childlike imagery, you know, and trying to sell ice cream as sexy in the first place, just no. And then also, the part of the video where Jenny is sharing a chip with a giant, whatever those South American giant rat things are called. Just watch the video, it's weird. All of that being said, I don't hate this song. And I could definitely classify this in guilty pleasure territory, but it's not something that I'm willing to defend this time. I'm sorry. Oh, I can make it right. All right. All right. And here's the other Pop Smoke song, this one featuring Lil Baby and DaBaby. And good thing I like this one a good bit more. It has a nice dreamy trap beat with that little guitar loop, and the song itself is really chill to listen to. I think the guests do fine on this song, and I don't mind them being here. I mean, I'm still not a big fan of Lil Baby, but I'm fine with it. Speaking of Lil Baby, you know FBE, the React channel? They did an episode of Lil Babies reacting to Lil Baby, and oh my god, that was funny. Because they're babies, and they don't know what the fuck rap is. Ha 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 ha. Yeah, otherwise, I like this song, but I probably wouldn't go out of my way to listen to it. But it's chill. I think anything I could possibly say about Rockstar by DaBaby, I or someone else has already said at this point, so I'm just gonna leave it at that. Saying like the last song, I've literally said everything I can possibly say about this. I have a soft spot for these bombastic types of songs. It's a decent rewritten revenge fantasy. The song's overmixed as hell. And this has been done better by Carrie Underwood. And also Gabby Barrett is from Pittsburgh. That's all I really have to say.
Giving me that good shit, that make me not quit, that good shit.
Yeah, I finally decided the What's Poppin' remix is actually good. I remember saying the original song was either bad or shit, I forget which tier I put it in, and some people were not too happy with that. But apparently this guy does have experience, and again, you got some pretty decent MCs on the mic, and the beat's catchy. This is really all you need. It's pretty chill and a nice vibe to listen to. I don't think I could get over the title, though. All caps, What's Poppin' with no apostrophe. Just, why? I'm dying over here. Save me, please. I do think it's kind of ironic that I've talked about being a K-pop fanatic this year, and I'm a week late, and I'm covering the week in the top 20 that there's two K-pop songs. Granted, they're both mostly in English, but still. Come on, what are the odds? Well, here we have BTS, and BTS is a group that I have an interesting relationship with. Okay, let me explain. When I first got into K-pop earlier this year, like hardcore, and didn't just listen to a very select number of girl groups, BTS were probably the first group I really got into, or the first boy group. I got super fangirly over them, I bought a bunch of stuff, a bunch of posters and merch, and I ended up watching their online concert. And honestly, I think a lot of their songs are really good. They have a lot of really good songs, and they're insanely talented. Now, one thing I do have to say is that their recent songs haven't done it for me, though. I didn't like On. I came to the conclusion that I didn't like On, and Boy With Love was fine. I am really tired of it being the only BTS song that non-ARMY like, although I can't even really consider myself ARMY anymore for fandom reasons that I'm not going to get into that have nothing to do with the group. It basically conflicts with another fandom that I'm in. I'll just put it that way. And it has nothing to do with the top 20, so I'm just gonna leave it at that. Anyway, what about the song Dynamite? This is BTS's first English song, even though they said they weren't gonna release English music, but fine, I'll give them credit. They did it for COVID, and it's had 2 weeks at number one. How the fuck did that happen? I almost wonder if this will have any longevity to make a year-end list. I think it's about time somebody like BTS makes a year-end list. Like, they've had enough impact on the global music scene, and also, I don't want to talk about the xenophobia that American radio stations have, but I just talked about it, so I really don't have much else to say. The song's funky and fun and loose, and it's enjoyable. I'm not the biggest fan of the autotune here, but it's definitely not as egregious as it was on, and the song overall is a lot more fun and loose to listen to than something like On. I do like this more than Boy With Love, if that says anything. You might hate me for that opinion, but Boy With Love is ruined by Halsey, let's just put it that way. Not that I hate Halsey, just why? Also, the only reason I don't like Boy With Love is because it's the only BTS song that I've gotten sick of just from people talking about how much they like it. People who don't know K-pop talking about how much they like it. I'm gonna sound as petty and pretentious as possible, but I'm just putting my honest opinions of songs out here. But yeah, I like it. What I don't like is the people incessantly telling me to stream obsessively and then streaming obsessively. Again, I can make a whole video about that, but I'm not going to, so. Otherwise, the song's good. Oh, God. I'm not even gonna lie. The song's filthy as hell. And this is also the best Cardi B has sounded in ages. I'm not gonna get into Cardi B's personal life, but I definitely feel like her star fell a good bit after some incidents came out about her. But what Cardi did is she pulled a very, very popular up-and-comer Megan Thee Stallion on here and made this song. And yeah, okay, content-wise, this isn't my thing, but what can I say? The song sounds good, the girls have tons of charisma, and the dance is fun as heck to watch. I'm not gonna go do some deep analysis about whether the song is feminist or not. I genuinely couldn't care less. Just, I don't care. This honestly feels like the Anaconda of 2020. And by that I mean everyone's gonna argue about if it's some female empowering anthem or if it's some derogatory shit. Just stop already. It ain't that deep, sis. As someone who isn't actively following the charts, I do really like this song. This is probably one of the best songs I've heard from Marshmello, to be completely honest, and so weird collaboration to begin with. But to hear Juice WRLD on an upbeat song like this, and also, Marshmello doesn't ruin the song. What can I really say? It's honestly got a bit of an electronic rock edge to it, while also still being a trap song, and it fits the tone of Juice WRLD, and it fits the tone of Marshmello. It doesn't suck all the life out of it, because Juice WRLD always had that kind of lifeless, bored, like, angsty sound to him anyway, and Marshmello's working with this, and honestly, that's all I can really say about this. The song is actually really good, I'm surprised. Wow. This is so catchy! I swear I've heard this guitar line somewhere before. If anyone knows where it's from, let me know, but what can I really say? These guys have decent charisma. They're on beat. The beat is insanely catchy. And I feel like this is the type of song that fits 2020 the best. I like this. Like, I really like this. Just some existential whinage about depression, but also trying to be in the mood at the same time and vibing. It honestly fits 2020 better than any song I've heard so far. What can I really say? Na, na, na,
na, na. Wow, fantastic, baby.
Die already! Okay, I'm gonna be honest here and say that it is incredibly commendable that Post Malone managed to break records by having a song chart in the top 20 for over a year. Good job, my guy. Genuinely, this is astonishing. The song has been in the top 20 for over a year. Sorry, what now? I really have nothing else to say about this. This is probably on track to be one of the biggest songs of all time. Am I complaining? Not really. Like I said, I think the biggest songs of all time charts don't really reflect the actual biggest songs of all time because of the way streaming's counted now compared to the way album sales were counted. You could play the same album over and over in your house and no one would know, so yeah. All that being said, Post Malone's Circles is a testament to longevity that really does obviously fit every season, and as much as I might complain and be sick of the song, this is the song that 10 years from now I'm gonna go back to and say, man, that song. Even more so than Sunflower. That's really all I have to say about it. Post, keep it up. Please make more songs like this. So we can stop listening to this one. Thank you. Well, it took me a while to actually put this in the great tier, but let's be honest here, this is probably one of the only 2020 hits I've actually listened to when it comes on. Like I said, most of this feels like work. I'm mostly listening to songs so I can make this video. Even if I like a song, I don't go out of my way to listen to it, because again, I got burned out of the charts, but this is probably the only one of the songs that I can just put on and chill with. It's insanely vibey, and I love the beat. I did hear a clip of the original Roses, and it's a much different song. And a much worse song, might I add. Imanbek really knows what he's doing. And honestly, the pitched up vocals and weird house beat make it really fitting. It's the kind of song to bump in your car when no one's around, which is pretty fitting for 2020, if I must say so. I don't know. I can just picture those guys bumping in their car, like, just doing like this. I should probably stop now. Also, I heard this song playing in hair salon. Harry Styles, thank you very much for making good music and saving 2020. Kudos. Harry Styles, thank you very much for making good music and saving 2020. Kudos. Okay, let's face it here. Dua Lipa is one of the defining pop artists going forward into the 2020s, and I could not be happier. Her throwback disco sound is insanely catchy and fun. Dua has a ton of charisma and a unique voice to back it up, and the song is just good. Yes, I do like this considerably more than Don't Start Now, and I did like Don't Start Now for the record. I still wish Physical could have been a hit, and Levitating is fucking awesome, but... And also Hallucinate, go listen to that one. But if another song from the album had to be a hit, I'm honestly glad it's this one. This song just hits a bit harder than Don't Start Now. It has a great bass groove, and it's pretty great. Honestly, you've got these songs on opposite sides of the spectrum here. Break My Heart, first of all, this pre-chorus. Dua's voice is angelic. All I can really say is this is this heartbreak type of song, whereas Don't Start Now is the getting over it type of song. And Physical is the in the moment. Honestly, Dua Lipa's future nostalgia, I am hoping will be a trend genre-defining album going forward. I'm genuinely hoping we'll get more music like this, not only from Dua, but from other stars as well. With this, The Weeknd's Blinding Lights, and the revival of Lady Gaga's disco sound, I have high hopes for music going forward. Not for much else, but for music, yes. Speaking of 80s throwbacks, speaking of longevity, speaking of great fucking songs, okay, I can finally sit here and admit that Blinding Lights by The Weeknd is fucking brilliant. What can I really say? This song is just a joy to listen to. It's smooth, it's fun, it's got a great vibe. Again, this is the thing you play on the highway at night. The funky 80s groove to it really seals the deal for me. And I'm a sucker for some good synth pop, and this does it. The Weeknd absolutely sells this song. I'm still not gonna say it's my favorite The Weeknd song. In the Night still has me sold on that. Just nothing will ever beat In the Night, in my opinion, but... Damn, Blinding Lights is actually really good, and... I'm not even gonna lie anymore. This has a very good shot at being very high up on my year-end best list if I ever decide to make that. Which I probably will when the year's over, but it's not over, so shut up. Anyway, that's The week, and again, 62 out of 100, pretty decent score, and definitely an interesting week, for sure. There isn't too much else to say about that, so, but before we go real quick, I gotta cover... Oh, Ava Max has another hit. Well, not really a hit, because it's not actually charting high, but it only debuted a couple weeks ago. This song has a chance, and I like this more than Sweet But a Psycho, honestly. Kings and Queens is a pretty dark-sounding song that still manages to be a female empowerment anthem instead of just some loose, generic beat. It actually sounds really interesting, and I like the way the song sounds with the multi-layered vocals on the chorus. And it also still sounds distinctly like Ava Max. So, yeah, this is a good song. I would definitely check this out. Now, this is one of the TikTok songs of 2020 that I actually like. I'm no longer on TikTok for personal reasons, but again, This song is great for aesthetics. There isn't too much else to say about it. It's kind of like Roses for me, in a song that just kind of I can listen to and space out. It's not as upbeat as Roses, it's a little more chill and laid back. But yeah, it's a song I can just kind of space out to, but it's relaxing and pleasant to listen to regardless, which is why I like it. Holy shit, Miley! This might be one of my favorite Miley Cyrus songs to date. And unfortunately, I feel like all the good Miley Cyrus songs tend to flop. Nothing Breaks Like a Heart. But no, really. I might like this more than Nothing Breaks Like a Heart. I do think Miley has proven herself as a true artist, and she can definitely do more than chart hits. And this is the song Getting Over Her Ex, and it's so good. Honestly, it's got this 80s synth kind of tone. It kind of reminds me of an old Lady Gaga song, or it's got a really great vibe to it. It's got a bit more country twinge than something like Lady Gaga would go, but this is still very much a pop song. And I'm a good sucker for synth pop, and again, this is another just euphoric lifting chorus, and all I can say to everyone is please fucking make this a hit. Like I said, I have high hopes for pop music going forward with all these songs. I'm so glad that 80s synth pop and disco are making revivals. Yes, I know disco is from the 70s. I meant 80s synth pop, comma, and disco. Before anyone yells at me. The point is, Miley's raspy vocals really work well here. And I can honestly see this song growing on me even more. I really don't have much else to say. The song is spectacular, and I can't wait to hear more from this era of Miley. I liked Mother's Daughter last year. I really liked Slide Away, but oh my god, Midnight Sky may just be the best song Miley has ever released. Please stream this. Seriously. I don't usually like to ask people to stream things, but this song deserves to be a hit. And since we couldn't make Physical a hit, please! Okay, I'll stop begging, but regardless of whether or not this becomes a hit, I still love it, and it's a fantastic song. Genuinely one of my favorite Western songs I've heard this year, and I'm happy for that. Good job, Miley. Kudos. See you all next time. Bye.